I would now like to welcome to the stage Sue Goldfish. He's going to talk to her about it yesterday. He was saying, talking a little bit about activism and the way that it can play out in your life. So, Sue.
I can see over the top of this. I always worry.
We'll see. Some tall man made this.
Anyway, thanks everyone for inviting me. Thank you so much for that welcome to country and acknowledge the Indigenous and Torres Strait Islander people here today. It's a privilege to be here. I'm just going to tell a story. I'm just going to read. So in 1972, my parents and I immigrated to Australia from Trinidad and Tobago in the West Indies. People assumed because I'm white, I was born in Australia, but I was born in the land of calypso and cricket. I was 13 when we came here. My father landed a job in a department store in Bondi Junction. My mother found work as a housekeeper, and I ended up at Dover High Girls High. The school was full of recent immigrants like me, so I wasn't the only person with an accent, but being white and having a West Indian accent was unusual. In 1972, Australia still had the white Australia policy. And in Trinidad, I'd experienced the rise of black nationalism, black identity politics. Then at school, I met a bunch of Jewish kids. One of my new friends said they thought my name Goldfish was Jewish. They were right, though I didn't know that. So at 13, I came to understand I was a Trinidadian who was white, who had a Jewish background, and it was also around the same time I realised I liked girls. Now, liking girls was just as complicated as being white coming from Trinidad or having a Jewish background, but also just as unavoidable. 6 years later, I was a third-year university student. I was actually at UNSW where I work now. And one crisp winter's morning, I joined a gay and lesbian rights demonstration. It was June 24th, 1978. I just turned 20, I was still fairly innocent, but I grew up quickly. The months that followed that day of protest felt like we were at war on the streets of Sydney. And I was proud to be one of those activists, arm in arm, out there, fighting the police, fending off the right to life, demanding our rights. We were making a new world for ourselves. It was the time of the women's warehouse, stray dags, ruby reds, women's services, other boots and flannel shirts for the ever so butch or slightly butch. I was a lesbian feminist. Soon I would end up working in an abortion clinic run by a women's collective, and we employed the doctors. I developed a keen sense of community politics, and I saw the power of activism. And we were out on the streets, not just for gay and lesbian rights, we were out there fighting for women's rights, abortion rights, land rights, a nuclear-free future, the fight to survive AIDS. I love being part of this community that championed human rights and who wanted to make a difference in the world. It was also when I fell in love with my first girlfriend. Those heady days of demonstrations and police arrests made a dramatic and perfect setting for new love. It also felt like the perfect moment to come out to my parents. As soon as my mother realised what I was going to say, she put her fingers in her ears and started humming really loudly. "Don't tell me anything I don't want to know," she said. "And for God's sakes, don't tell your father." So I didn't tell my father. We would not speak again of my sexuality or my relationships. A terrible, empty, silent space in our lives. And don't get me wrong, I loved my parents and they loved me, but they couldn't accept me as their lesbian daughter. And at times, and I'm sure you all know this, it was profoundly painful. Now recently I made a film, why not, about my family called The Last Goldfish. My parents were the only family I had in Australia, and as I grew older, I discovered my father Manfred had secrets. For instance, I had no idea he was Jewish, and he'd lost most of his family in the Holocaust. It was why he ended up in Trinidad in 1939. He was a refugee, and very lucky to have made it there. A few days after he arrived, the British colonial authorities, because it was under British control at that time, changed policy and started actually turning away the boats with Jewish refugees like him. Sound familiar? It's well practiced. So it was an incredible journey of discovery making this film, and I've been enjoying sharing it with people in festivals all around the world. I really wanted to remind people that many of us in Australia come from the families of refugees and displaced people. Now in the film I go looking for the family my father left behind in Germany. I wonder, is there really no one else in the world with a name Goldfish? I'm the only one in Australia, that's for sure. When I asked my father about this, he said, "Nah, you're the last one." So I also discovered my father was married before, so he had a few secrets, and he had two other children. This is something he also neglected to tell me. He said he didn't know where they were, so the film again tracks my journey as I search for my brother and sister and anyone else on his side of the family. And because my parents didn't accept my sexuality, whenever I find someone that I'm related to, I come out to them. And then I wait to see how they react. It's a test. I decided I didn't need any more family in my life who didn't approve of me. Now at 32, I find my half-brother and sister, an extraordinary life-changing moment for all of us. But I had to do the test, and my heart was in my mouth when I told them I was a lesbian. I was so scared I'd be rejected, and to my huge relief and joy, they totally embraced me. In fact, when I tell my brother I'm a lesbian, all he says is, "We both love women." A little bit sleazy, but no, it's appreciated. But isn't it incredible, acknowledging the fear of rejection that we carry in us? It's incredible. It's particularly when those close to us disapprove of our relationships, and this is where I come back to community. So throughout this whole journey, my community of friends and my partners, although it was a few journeys, it was a long journey with a few partners, but my partner's family of the moment also, very supportive. They held me safe. They always bear the alternative family I made for myself, strong and true and a precious part of my life. So my father left behind his culture and his history. He had lost so much. He no longer believed in religions or nations. He wanted to be, and he often spoke about this, he just wanted to be a citizen of the world. And I share that belief. We must see the world as a place we all share, that we are all responsible for. There actually aren't any borders. We made them up. But we also need a sense of belonging, of knowing where we feel safe, where we can thrive, where we are accepted in all our complexity. Now, winning that appalling vote on our lives and loves brought home to me how important it is to have a legal framework for justice and equality. We need our government, our institutions, and our services to represent us, to be us, which all of you are, to support the building of strong and sustainable communities. And because we have to be strong to save this planet, we have battles to fight, refugee policies that are criminal and inhumane, ongoing discrimination because of our sexuality, our race, or our gender, insidious, creeping environmental destruction, the dismantling of our public services and institutions, the corruption of public discourse. And we need each other to stay strong in the face of all that. We are each other's family, and when we get together, we're a pretty powerful force. Now, I'm going to just show you a little tiny snippet of the film. It's a tiny bit of self-promotion. It is available on DVD and VOD if you Google me. But I just want to show you a tiny bit of it. The point that we're coming in is I still haven't found my brother and sister. I'm in my 20s and life's pretty good. And have a really wonderful conference. I hope you enjoy this and thank you.
And anyway, I've run out of money and it's time to go home. I reinvent myself. I don't really like my full name, Suzanne Goldfish. I become Sue Fish. I'm a DJ and a performer. I become a carpenter and a set maker. I work in the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Mardi Gras workshop, building floats for the parades and parties. Parents don't approve of my sexuality. The gulf between us grows. But I'm creating an alternative family, and over time, this intimate community binds me to Australia.